Hi. One of the coolest things about microcontrollers is you can use code running on your chip to interact with the real physical world. In previous videos, we have shown you how you can sense the real world with things like photodiodes, temperature sensors, or even mechanical switches. We have also talked a little bit about how you can actuate the real world with things like motors and servos. But we have yet to talk about one of the simplest forms of electromechanical actuators out there, the solenoid. In order to demonstrate the solenoid concept and bring a little Christmas cheer to the office, we decided to put together a xylophone that plays itself.
In order to build our robotic xylophone, the first thing we had to do was, well, build a xylophone. We found these scrap aluminum bars in our workshop, and when we gave them a hit, they made a pretty nice tone. So we decided to see if we could tune these bars to the specific musical notes we wanted.
We found a book called The Theory of Sound, published in 1877 and written by the now famous physicist Lord Rayleigh. There's an entire chapter called Lateral Vibrations of Bars, which sets up the fourth order differential equations that are involved in even a simple model of this problem.
Basically, when I hit the bar like this, we've got what's called a free bar, which means it's not being clamped at either end. The initially flat bar will bend a little bit like this. And then a fraction of a second later, it'll spring back the other way. And just like a mass in a spring, it'll keep flexing back and forth and pushing on the air around it, which makes the sound waves that we ultimately hear. So let's figure out what factors influence the frequency that our bar will vibrate at. First, there's the material itself. A more dense bar will vibrate at a lower frequency because there's more mass to accelerate as the bar springs back. Then there's the stiffness or elasticity of the material. A less stiff material will vibrate at a lower frequency because it has to displace farther before it springs back. Then there's the geometry of the bar. A thinner bar will vibrate at a lower frequency because it's less stiff. And finally, there's the length of the bar. A longer bar will vibrate at a lower frequency because the wave has to travel longer. So for our bars, we're going to keep these first three the same, and we're just going to vary the length to vary the frequency of our bars.
If we hit the books again, we'll find that for a given material, the frequency of vibration varies inversely as the square of the length. That means that if we take one bar and measure its length and frequency, we can figure out how long a bar needs to be to get a different frequency. That's exactly what we did, making a spreadsheet of different notes that we wanted to make, and then cutting and milling bars down to length. Each time, we made the bars a little bit longer than our equation said to. And then measured the frequency again and figured out how much to cut off to get as close as possible to the final frequency.
The last part of making the bars is figuring out how to hold them. If we constrain the bars too much, they won't be able to vibrate. But if we jump back to the books, we'll find this graph which shows the shape of vibrations in the bar.
If we hold the bar gently at these two points, called nodes, we'll interfere as little as possible with the vibration that we're looking for. So we drilled holes at these positions, about 22% of the way from either end of the bar, and mounted the bars on rubber washers.
At that point, we had a plain old xylophone. So the next step was to build electromechanical actuators to let the microcontroller strike each bar at the right time. Solenoids are one of the most basic electromechanical actuators. To understand them, we have to go back to physics, and remember that a current in a wire will create a magnetic field around it. Then, we can make a loop of wire, and now, the magnetic field from all of these little segments of wire add up, so we get a field that's strongest in the middle, and weaker on the outsides. Finally, we can take one long piece of wire and wrap it around as a solenoid coil. Now we have a bunch of loops, and the magnetic field contributions from all of these loops add up. This lets us get one field that's really strong in the center.
At this point, we've made an electromagnet, where we can turn a magnetic field on and off with just a current. So, just like a permanent magnet is attracted to iron and steel objects, so is our electromagnet when there's a current running through it.
Now we're going to take our coil and add a steel slug. When the coil is off, gravity is going to pull the slug down. But when we put a current through the coil, it'll start acting like an electromagnet, and the steel slug will be attracted to the strongest part of the magnetic field. This is near the center of the coil, so the slug will jump up a little bit.
We can demo that here, and you can see the steel slug moving up and down as I apply and remove current.
We made our own solenoid forms by turning down some plastic on the lathe. First, we cut channels on the outside to hold our wires. And then, we drilled out the center to act as a channel for our solenoid's moving slug. We tapped a small hole on the other side so we could mount the coils on our xylophone. Finally, we wound several hundred turns of magnet wire around each coil, fixed the whole coil with a little bit of superglue, and carefully stripped the enamel insulation from each end with a knife.
Right now, we only have an actuator that can pull into the center of the solenoid, but we need something that will shoot up towards the xylophone bar. The most basic mechanical option would be to put a little non-magnetic rod on top of the slug, but we wanted to use less electrical power and get more force so we could have a louder xylophone strike. So we ended up modifying the solenoid concept a little bit. We attached some permanent magnets to the top of our steel slug, so now there's always a magnetic field around it. When we have one magnet and one piece of iron, we can only have an attractive force, but once we have two magnets, we can have either attraction or repulsion. One of these magnets is our permanent magnet, guided by our steel slug, and the other one is the electromagnet. So we can draw this in the resting position, with the slug and magnet just above the center of the coil, and then when we put a current through the coil in the right direction, we'll actually get a force that pushes down on the coils and pushes up on the magnet and steel slug. Now the math for magnetic fields is generally a bit tricky, but let's just say that we get a lot more force for a lot less current by taking advantage of permanent magnets. By letting current run through the solenoid briefly, the slug will jump up and hit the xylophone bar. To let the microcontroller actuate each coil, we've got to build a circuit that can handle the switching action. We're going to use a MOSFET as a switch, which we've talked about in many previous NerdKits videos, such as the server exploiter video, Motors and Microcontrollers 101, and the iPhone remote controlled car video. Now, in this case, we're going to have a microcontroller controlling the gate of the MOSFET, which acts like a switch, opening and closing and letting current flow through our solenoid coil. Now, there's one special trick here, because this is definitely an inductive load. That means there's energy stored in the magnetic field. So when this coil goes from on to off, all of that energy needs to go somewhere. If we don't do anything about it, the voltage at this node is going to rise very high very quickly, until eventually this MOSFET breaks down and lets some current flow, even though it's supposed to be off. To fix that, we're going to do what we usually do, which is to put a reverse bias diode across the inductor. In this case, we decided to do something special, which is to use an LED. So when this switches from on to off, the voltage starts to rise, but then current is allowed to flow through the LED. We take some of the energy from the magnetic field and turn it into light energy. It's basically free energy that would have been wasted anyway, and now we get to actually see when each of our coils is done firing. So anyway, this is a little basics of controlling inductive loads. For more information, take a look at our Motors and Microcontrollers 101 video. Finally, let's put together the bars and the solenoids. We just send a current pulse through the solenoid for a few milliseconds, and we've got music.
The code running on the microcontroller is actually not all that complicated. There are two main timing issues you need to worry about: timing when the next note should be played, basically the tempo of the song, and timing how long you need to pulse each coil on for when playing each note. The amount of energy delivered to the solenoid depends on how long you pulse the coil on for, so leaving it on for longer gives you a louder ping.
We simply use two separate timers and timer interrupts to handle these two time intervals. There is a little bit of math done to change the beats per minute of the song into the value needed to set the output compare register.
At this point, we could have driven each individual coil directly from our MCU. This would have taken 8 digital output pins on our microcontroller, and it would have worked just fine. However, we thought this would be a great opportunity to introduce a very useful digital component, the shift register. For this project, we use an 8-bit shift register, which means it sets 8 digital outputs that we can control. This is a digital component, so you can interface with it directly from your MCU.
A shift register will typically use two inputs, a data input and a clock. When the clock line pulses, the shift register takes the state of its output pins and shifts them over by 1, shifting in the current value of your data input. The state will be held until you pulse the clock line again, and the bits shift over again, and the new bit gets shifted in. Say we wanted to have the second note go on and all the other notes off. If we were using the straight MCU pins, we would just turn that bit high, but with a shift register, we need to shift the bits in one at a time. First, we need to shift in 6 zeros, because remember we want all the other nodes to be off. So we set the data line low, and pulse the clock to shift in the first 0. Then again to shift in the next 0, and so on until we have 6 zeros. We then put a 1 on the data input, then pulse the clock to shift it in. Then we shift in the last 0. To clear the shift register, we would just shift in 8 zeros. Note that you can shift in any combination of 1s and 0s you want. They are just like pins on an MCU you can set.
This may sound like a lot of work to go through when I could just set the MCU pins, but notice that I am able to set 8 outputs with only 2 inputs. Even more interesting is that I could chain another 8-bit shift register together by connecting the data input of this register to the last output of the previous register and connecting it to the same clock line. Now, the bits would continue propagating through and I could set 16 outputs with the same 2 inputs. With a shift register, you're basically trading time for more pins.
To write the code to do this, you could write a function that sent out a full byte to the shift register, toggling a digital clock pin at the right time. However, there is a module on board the chip, the SPI bus, that happens to do exactly that for you. The SPI bus takes a byte that you give it in code, and it shifts it out bit by bit over its MOSI pin, toggling the clock line at the right time. The SPI bus has the advantage that it can clock out the bits much faster than you would be able to in the code.
So in our code, we use the SPI bus to set the shift register, which activates the right coil, which induces a magnetic field, which repels the magnet, which moves up to strike the bar. After a little while, we shift in zeros, and the slug moves back down. Then repeat when it's time for the next note. Do this in the right order, and you get jingle bells. We hope you learned something about solenoids and enjoyed watching our robotic xylophone. For more information about our kits or more videos like this one, please visit us at www.nerdkits.com.